and I welcome to you to this service of Holy Communion, and I guess we should pray as we begin. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Father God, we thank you for calling us here today, for our fellowship together, for the love we share in you. Help us this morning to hear not just what we want to hear, but what you have to say. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And back to Norway.
Thank you. So we're going to begin by singing our first hymn. So if you're able, would you please stand? So it's time for our young people to come forward and go to their group. What would it look like for you this morning? Nice to see you. Seems small to downstairs this morning. No, not yours, Rod.
Not that one.
Oh, how lovely. Fabulous. Summary as well. They've gone. So let's pray for you. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for the blessing of children, and we just pray that as they grow, they will come to know you more and more in their lives. And we thank you for this morning and for the leaders who are going to be with them to show them more of your love. We pray for you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Go on and have a good time. And can we have our first reading, please?
The first reading is from Romans 4, verses 13 to 25. It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be the heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who depend on the law are heirs, faith means nothing, and the promise is worthless, because the law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace, and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is our father in the sight of God, in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead, and calls into being things that were not. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened by his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words it was credited to him were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him. And Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying this, a synagogue leader came and knelt before him and said, "My daughter has just died, but come and put your hand on her, and she will live."
touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be healed." Jesus turned and saw her. "Take heart, daughter," he said. "Your faith has healed you." And the woman was healed at that moment. When Jesus entered the synagogue leader's house and saw the noisy crowd and people playing pipes, he said, "Go away, the girl is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took the girl by the hand, and she got up. News of this spread through all that region. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This morning by reminding you of a couple of important life savers, things you should already know about. The first is that if you have an accident and as a result you are seriously incapacitated, then you qualify for an ambulance. The second is that if you are unwell, a local pharmacy can't help you anymore, then you qualify for a doctor, if you can get one. Both of the aforementioned are pretty much shared common knowledge that many can benefit from if they qualify as a UK citizen or a dependent. The NHS might be a bit creepy right now, but I, among many, have much to thank our health service for. However, there's a third that I think far greater lifesaver, but not so many know much, if anything, about, and that others have heard of yet either treat with suspicion or feel that it's too good to be true. So it gets largely ignored as a life-saving possibility. There are, of course, many other lifesavers we could talk about, but the one I want to focus on is this. If you're a sinner, you qualify for a saviour. If you're a sinner, you qualify for a saviour. You should be smiling at that. As I'm a sinner, I think it's good news. Anyway, for this, there are no exclusions. Everyone is included. It doesn't matter where you come from or where you live. It doesn't depend upon gender or class or ethnicity. Doubt is not a barrier. You simply need to know you have need of a saviour. And if you know you're a sinner and in need of help, then I'm going to say welcome to the club. Although the membership runs into billions worldwide, we're nowhere near full up yet, and never will be. There's no waiting list, and all you have to do is admit your need of the Saviour, and he will do the rest, in person. Our gospel today began with Jesus, our Saviour, calling Matthew, a Jewish tax collector, to follow him Now, tax collectors were despised by the Jews because they collected taxes for the occupying Roman oppressors, and also because many tax collectors used their position to levy much more tax than was legally required, adding to their own personal wealth. So the tax collectors were declared by the Pharisees, those religious leaders of the day, to be social outcasts and sinners. And so to the Jewish leaders, Jesus, in associating with Matthew, was, as they say, adding insult to injury. First, he had a friendly conversation with Matthew, during which he invited him to become one of his followers. And then he'd gone to Matthew's house, where he ate a meal with him, and with other tax collectors and sinners. Now the big question for me at this particular point is, did the Pharisees, those strict keepers of the law, have a right, perhaps even a duty, to point out to Jesus that he was associating with those who seemed to have deliberately rejected God's values? Was that their job? Well, if we're truly honest, how would we feel if Jesus came and spent more time with the groups and gangs destroying vandalites and the cheats and scammers who by stealth seek to rob the vulnerable of their savings? Wouldn't we feel pretty much as the Pharisees did towards Jesus in our gospel today? It's worth thinking about. Maybe the real issue here is that the vast majority of the religious leaders of that day could never see the bigger picture. Perhaps if they tried just a little bit harder, they might have seen the changes in those who responded to Jesus' invitation. And that although this vibrant preacher who drew people to himself behaved in such a very unconventional manner, he was making a real difference to people's lives. He was actually helping those who were pretty bad to become better people. To become good in the sight of God. Our gospel today began by recording the fact that Jesus called Matthew to follow him. And of course the inevitable opposition, it seems, of the religious leaders to all that Jesus was doing. And this was followed by two accounts of Jesus' miraculous healing power. The healing of a woman who'd been hemorrhaging for 12 years, and the raising from death of the synagogue leader's daughter. At first sight, it seems there's nothing much to connect these three separate happenings. And it can all seem a bit of a jumble. But I don't think that it's by accident that these accounts are placed in that particular order. I believe they're so placed because calling and faith and wholeness and healing are all vital signs of God at work in the world and in the lives of every individual. Matthew, for instance, he must have had enough faith in Jesus to leave what was considered a lucrative lifestyle, leave that behind to face an unknown future with someone he hardly knew. His calling surely was God inspired, God driven. Why would he follow Jesus if that were not so? Now what about those two miracles that followed? We've got two people who sought out Jesus for his help in what can only be described as dire circumstances. Both had sufficient faith to seek him out, risking ridicule and disappointment if their faith turned out to be unfounded. But as we heard in our reading, their faith was rewarded. These three different stories in our gospel today reveal our God in action in individual lives, calling, inspiring, giving hope. Hope found only in Jesus, Saviour, Healer, and Physician of sick souls. The only one who can make us new in body, mind, and spirit. the only one who has the power to confer the riches of the kingdom upon sinners and upon outcasts. This is our God. This is our King. Still no smiles, but he's ours to share. After the calling of Matthew in our Gospel today, we have two quite different people from very different social backgrounds. They came to Jesus with different needs, yet their approaches have these three things in common. They had faith that Jesus could do something. They came with confidence that he had power to do what no one else could do. And they came risking everything in taking their needs to the Lord. And that's faith. As far as we know, neither the synagogue leader nor the woman had any previous personal contact or first-hand experience of Jesus. But they were obviously well aware of his healing powers. Maybe they'd been present on another occasion when Jesus had healed. We simply don't know. Scripture doesn't tell us any more about their background. But the text makes it clear that both came in great need, in fact in desperate need, and that their faith was equal to the needs that they came with. Now to have any kind of faith is good. The faith that is fitful or half-hearted can limit God's power. But here in this remarkable account from Matthew, we have ample evidence of strong faith leading to the release of God's healing, life-giving power in all its fullness. By faith, both the synagogue leader and the woman received all that they had hoped for in coming to Jesus. The woman was first to receive. Take heart, daughter. Your faith has healed you. Then the synagogue leader, for whom there had been such a long wait, he had his faith rewarded as Jesus took his daughter by the hand and raised her up. So an anonymous person once said, faith is not real faith until it's all you're holding on to. And then we have this from a guy called George Muller. He founded an orphanage for youngsters in the south of England. He said this: faith does not operate in the realm of the possible. There is no glory for God in that which is humanly achievable. Faith begins where man's power ends. I suppose at this point another question to ask of ourselves is, do we believe in a Lord who has power to cancel out evil? A creator God who is Lord of all, who has power over life and death, and who is deeply committed to us and concerned for our well-being? Or is that just a nice thought? A pleasant possibility, well worth considering. Having faith means knowing who and what we are pinning our hopes on. There's a Polish proverb that says, to believe with certainty, we must begin with doubt. And we all have doubts of one kind or another, at some time or other. But we also have a God who understands us, and he wants to draw us ever closer to dispel our fears and build up our faith, who bids us come to him as first choice. But if that's not possible, even as a last resort. Synagogue leader came even though his standing as leader at the local synagogue would be at great risk. He came with confidence and with great faith. Jesus had all the power necessary to change the awful situation that he and his family were facing. And the woman She also prayed with great faith. After 12 long years of suffering and being kept at a distance, because you know that's what her illness had meant for her, she would probably be considered unclean, not very nice to know. In a polite and proper society, she would be shunned, not able to go to the temple or join the crowd in the marketplace. She was a loner. This woman was not only ill, but she was an outcast in much the same way as lepers were outcasts. Yet her faith in Jesus drew her closer to him. If I can just touch his cloak, I will be healed. So she touched, and she was. Now if anyone should ask you if you have to be really good, have to be really holy to follow Jesus, your answer should be definitely not. You do have to be interested in who he is and all that he stands for, and you do have to aspire to a way of life that tries to live out his teaching on loving and on caring for others. Impossible to achieve in our own strength, but with the Lord's help, it can happen, albeit so very, very gradually. And the only qualification required on our part is a willing to believe by faith that it will. Now there are two words that spring out and engage me from today's gospel. Follow me. Follow me. Because that's what Jesus asked us to do. And follow me has to be more than just looking, just observing what Jesus does and noting what he says. Any scholar can do that. Follow me implies to me that we try to copy what he does. It's more of an invitation not just to see, but to follow where he leads us. And that may often be to places that the world might not consider to be all that holy. Follow me, says Jesus, as I call Matthew and people like him to be my disciples. Follow me as I relate to men and women who may well be despised by some and think of themselves as holy and religious. Follow me as I interact with men and women who are shunned and resented because they're very rich or because they're very poor. And as I associate with men and women who've done and may still be doing bad things, and men and women who are simply unwell, or who feel left out of it, and so want to be included. Follow me as I make friends with such as these. That's what Jesus asks of us. To follow Jesus as true disciples means being content to be with him, whoever he calls, and to follow him and to rejoice with all who own his name. And if we think of some of them, that some of them are a bit iffy because they don't quite reach the high standards we think are required, then let's just try to remember that Jesus is still working on me and you. And that's why we pray, your will be done. So that we might see things through his eyes. So then, how did you come to church today? I don't mean did you come by car or on a skateboard. It doesn't really matter whether you came by kite or even by camel. Although some of those forms of transport will almost certainly get you a mention on the news. But what I mean is this, did you come today just to be with friends? Or did you come today to meet together with your friends in Jesus? Did you come to church today because you like the company and it sets you up for the week? Or did you come in faith, knowing your need? And I mean honestly knowing God's healing plan. We can't really belong to Jesus unless we know who he is. Until we know by interacting with each other about the wonderful things he does in our lives and the lives of others. Sharing our thoughts and prayers and talking together week by week is a great way to share this vital information and build up our faith in the one who calls us, heals us, and bids us come to him, just like the leader from the synagogue and the woman who'd been bleeding for 12 years. He bids us come just as we are. Amen.
I think we should sing our next hymn, just sitting where we are and singing it prayerfully. So Lord, as we kneel at your feet, receive our heartfelt worship. May it be a pleasing and fragrant offering only for you. As sinners we know, we are unfit to draw near, and yet you welcome and embrace us, because your compassion is without end, and you are so eager to forgive. Our love can never match the love you show, but still, we will give all we have hearts be to you an offering of thanks and praise, so that you alone are glorified above all things. Lord, we bring before you the world in which we live. You see the violence, the suffering, the hatred, the destruction, and injustice. Your heart must grieve. As Lord of all, we trust that you will continue to pour your living waters into this thirsty world, so that violence gives way to peace, suffering turns to healing, destruction gives way to growth, and injustice makes way for truth and fairness. Grant wisdom and humility to all our leaders, so that strengthened and guided by your life-changing power, they may work through any situation in accordance with your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we give to you our own community, its character, strengths and weaknesses. We thank you for our homes and neighbours, and ask that you would bless them with your spirit. We lift to you the vulnerable members of the community, and ask that empowered by you, we might show them your love and compassion. May this church be a place of refreshment and refuge for the weary or the broken. And may we shine as a bright star, leading people to you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we bring before you the sick, the suffering, and those in need. You have power over all things, and we ask you to heal, comfort, and provide for the people we lift to you now. Please feel free to call out the names of those people who are on your hearts. Lord Jesus, fill us with your compassion, so that we might reach out to those who need us and spark fresh hope into their lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we give you our thanks. You have shown us such grace and given us true hope. You are the one true King who deserves our offerings of worship and love, before and above all things. Together with all saints, heavenly hosts, and all of creation, we will proclaim how great you are. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Share the peace together, and you can do that by hug, handshake, or just a wave, according to how you feel about these things. We leave it entirely to you, but in any case, will you please stand? Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And share that peace with one another.
Peace, Lord, all in my love.
Great to see someone's becoming braver to be around. Excellent. So we're going to stand and sing again, how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure.
Creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. when we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him, and he in us.
You opened his arms to the world on the cross, and made for all the hurt and sacrifice to sin.
On the night he was betrayed, supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we prepare his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink his holy bread, may us all in Christ our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Father, fire, and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, so shine in the highest.
Being made one by the power of the Spirit, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Eat and drink these holy gifts in remembrance that Christ died for you, and that Christ lives for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Before we receive, we pray together.
We acknowledge you to come to this table, and the vessel of the Lord, trusting in our righteousness.
Thank you.
So we say together our prayer after communion. Almighty God, we pray. reminder that there's a prayer meeting on Tuesday morning at 10:30, that there are Bible studies on Wednesday evening at 7:30 or Thursday afternoon at 1:45, and that the church is open on Thursdays from 10:30 till 7, where we have refreshments in the morning, soup and gruel at lunchtime, and then stay on for the Bible study if you want. Luke keeps asking me to say this, and I keep forgetting to say it. If you're at the front of the church at the end of the service, and the recording hasn't been switched off, please make sure that your conversation is suitable for the recording. Okay, until it's switched off. Any more notices from anybody? No? In that case, we'll sing together and find him. Oh, sorry, Pat. Right, so yesterday there was a car boot sale, wasn't there, that Maggie and Pat took goods to, and some people provided. They were raising funds for the rails on the steps and up the slope. The rails, you probably noticed, is falling apart, and they raised £73 yesterday, so that's... reminder that if you want to make a contribution to the work of St Paul's, I've not changed the slide. You don't need to bring it to the front, someone will bring a background and you can put your contribution in if you'd like to. So we're going to sing our final hymn, Great is Our Faithfulness, O God my Father. Please stand if you're ready.
Thank you.
so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
Amen.